Majesty. How do you find me?
You are the sun, Majesty. The glory lion.
It is hard to believe that once I was young, I was beautiful. Your father knew me as such.
I warn you that I might be going to speak for an hour, but I won't. And my fellow actors will keep me well within limits, let alone Rudolph, Roland. Sorry. Cheers. Well, I'm playing Elizabeth in the very, very last years of her life. And so that's a very specific, shock-ridden, horror-ridden spectrum moment of her life. It's a kind of black hole in some respects, in which there's some gleams of sunlight. And they're brief, and they're young, and she believes they betray her. And I bear in mind that all the reading that I've done, that this is a woman who, when she was age 3, her father raised her to the heights, and crowds adored her. And then, when she was a teenager, she was in the tower and expected to be executed, and many times murdered, and specifically after the Pope excommunicated her. And she was the monarch who was the head of a despotic regime, which is the same thing as a totalitarian regime. And it's very interesting, the fractures in this extraordinary creature, of whom there have been some writers who have given much insight, and I only hope that I've been able to respond to the Roland and the script sufficiently to be able to just give a little glimpse of that, this fracturing, this black hole with shafts of brief sunlight. What you were just saying about, literally just now, about this jingoistic, imperialistic sort of atmosphere that accrued over a period. But we're sitting in a reproduction of the Rose Theatre. And some years back, when Mrs. Thatcher was our Prime Minister, by mistake, the Rose Theatre was discovered in the course of building a great new city glass block. And somebody blew the whistle. They weren't supposed to, and they rang up some of the archaeologists who are supposed to have the right to examine foundations, discoveries, remains, bones, you name it. And blowing the whistle, he lost his job. But the fact was that suddenly it became clear an office block of gigantic proportions was going to bury the Rose Theatre, the only existing remains of Shakespeare's time, and the writers, the dramatists, the audiences, the actors who actually played, a big tourist attraction in England. And all the actors fought a big battle, and so did people from all over the world. get a stop on the glass block tower being built, and our leading actress, wonderful woman, went and sat in the mud. I just noticed the mud as we came in. She sat in the mud in front of the bulldozers as they rolled up to stop them destroying the rose. The campaign failed because, as a friend of mine who was sitting next to Mrs. Thatcher at a banquet, she said, I wasn't going to be dictated to by a bunch of actors. But that was the respect for this extraordinary contradiction that this woman who seemed to, Prime Minister, who seemed to embody imperialism and everything else, had absolutely no respect for the finest treasure that had ever been found in England of Elizabethan theatre. Sorry to go on, Roland. You know, John Barton, who worked with Peter Hall during the 8 years that he was artistic director of the Royal Shakespeare Theatre at Stratford-on-Avon, and he gave a whole series of master classes with the actors and so on. And the point is that in those days, no one spoke what we think of as English. They spoke with dialect. They spoke much nearer to American, actually, than English. So who can say today what is contemporary English or what is Shakespearean English? Shakespearean English would have been in every kind of dialect, including French, German, and Italian, with quite a few Arabs thrown in, and so on and so forth, Italians as well, of course. So we've all faced a lot of, haven't we, during our lives, of misconceptions as to Shakespeare and modern language or Shakespeare's language.